Simon & Schuster Audio presents Ghost Sniper, a Sniper Elite novel by Scott McEwen with Thomas Koloniar. Read by Brian Hutchison.
This book is dedicated to the memory of the 30 Americans who lost their lives in Afghanistan on the mission Extortion 17, including 17 members of SEAL Team 6. It was the most devastating loss of life in the history of the United States Navy SEAL teams. Some of these men were personal friends of mine. All of them were warriors and patriots of this nation. Respect. Prologue. Paris, France. Gil looked over at his best and often reckless friend.
So tell me about this girl.
Crossway took a drag from a cigarette.
Not much to tell.
I know better than that.
You moved to a communist country to be with her, for Christ's sake.
It's actually not all that communist anymore, just dirt poor. They were crossing a storage lot on the outskirts of Paris, not far from the rail yard, where Gil had had his first run-in with Chechen sniper Sasha Kovalenko.
So you're not going to tell me about her?
Well, she's a little younger than me.
How young?
21.
Gil whistled. 21's a good age. She wants to get married soon, have a baby.
You should do it, Gil said, lighting a cigarette of his own. Be good for you. The idea of having a kid freaks me out. And what happens when you get yourself in another jam? Who's going to save your ass?
Don't use me to try and wiggle out of it, Gil said. Besides, I was just in another jam. You were nowhere around.
Yeah, and you damn near died from what I hear.
I damn near died the other two times.
Crosswhite stopped and turned to face him.
Fuck is that supposed to mean?
Means I think you should get married and have a baby, dumbass.
Yeah, Crosswhite said with a sigh. Sure.
They set off walking again.
She's Catholic. I gotta start going to church on Sundays. I hate fucking church.
It ain't gonna kill you.
You'll have to stop with the drugs, too.
Already did.
You talked to Marie lately?
Gil became immediately sad at the mention of his wife.
She doesn't want me back until I'm out for good. And I just ain't ready to quit.
You know these young guys coming up, Crosswhite said.
They're faster, stronger, and more dangerous than we are.
I know it, partner, but I ain't ready. They arrived at an orange overhead garage door with a big white number 9 stenciled on the front of it.
So what the fuck do you suppose is going to be in there?
Crosswhite wondered aloud.
A booby trap?
Gil tossed the cigarette to the ground and stepped on it.
I doubt it.
You're absolutely positive you don't want to tell Pope about this first?
Yeah.
Gil stepped forward, inserted the key in the lock, and gave it a turn. The door went up automatically, and both men stood staring.
You gotta be shitting me, Crosswhite said.
The phone in Gil's pocket rang.
Hello?
So what's behind door number 9? Pope asked.
Gil glanced up at the sky, not at all surprised.
I think you'd better get on a plane and come have a look for yourself.
Robert Pope, director of the CIA, arrived in Paris the next day, returning with Gil and Crosswhite to the storage unit. Gil inserted the key into the electric lock, and the door rose slowly, revealing numerous ammo and weapons crates stacked at the back. What caught Pope's attention, however, was the wooden workbench against the wall with a large lump sitting on top of it covered with a green canvas tarp.
The crates are full, Gil remarked.
What's under the tarp? Pope asked.
Grinning, Crosswhite stepped in and pulled it back, revealing 200 neatly stacked bars of shiny gold bullion. Each bar was stamped 1000G/999.9 gold. He watched Pope's eyes for any hint of shock or surprise, but there was none.
How many bars? Pope asked.
200,
Gil replied. Pope did the math in his head.
That's almost $9 million. Close the door and give me the key.
Crosswhite shot a startled glance at Gil, and then back at Pope.
What the hell are you talking about, give you the key?
Pope didn't reply.
Come on out, Gil said quietly.
Hey, this puts us on easy street, Crosswhite said. Mission complete. Game over. Winner takes all.
This puts us in business, Pope said, his blue eyes piercing. Now close the door and give me the key.
Gil, what the fuck?
Gil turned the key. The door began to close, and Crosswhite stepped out quickly, incredulous.
Don't tell me you're down with this. You're going to let him take all of it for himself?
Gil took the key from the wall and handed it to Pope.
Let's go. We got a plane to catch.
1. 6 months later. Distrito Federal, Mexico City, Mexico. 0845 hours. Chance Vaught stood in the back hall of the U.S. Embassy in Mexico City, talking with Bill Lewis, U.S. Ambassador to Mexico. A former Green Beret with 8 years of combat experience in Iraq and Afghanistan, Vaught was now working as a special agent with the U.S. Diplomatic Security Service, DSS. Currently, he was the special agent in charge of security for Alice B. Downley, the director of the Office of National Drug Control Policy, the Drug Czar.
So you're telling me we have to run the gauntlet between here and the Mexican Senate building?
Asked Vaught, 30 years old, with green eyes and a black goatee, set in a Latin visage.
I thought the entire week was scheduled for here in the embassy. What the hell happened?
Between you and me? Lewis lowered his voice. Downley offended the Mexican delegation yesterday, namely Lázaro Serrano, first by suggesting they allow U.S. Special Forces teams into Mexico to act as advisors in their war against the cartels, and then by implying the teams would operate independently, the same way our operatives did down in Colombia back in Pablo Escobar's day. Vaught rolled his eyes in disbelief.
Comparing Mexico to Colombia, very diplomatic.
He took a can of Copenhagen tobacco from the cargo pocket of his trousers and put a dip into his lower lip. He was sure that the security at the Mexican Senate building, known in Mexico as La Casona de Chico Tencatl, would be tight. But he would have zero control there. Meetings held off U.S. Embassy grounds were always cause for heightened anxiety, and it was a growing problem for the DSS all over the globe. After the Osama bin Laden orchestrated terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, billions of American dollars were spent fortifying U.S. embassies, making them look more like supermax prisons than houses of diplomacy, and many foreign diplomats simply refused to meet in the blocky, fortress-like structures. This forced American diplomats to take meetings in less secure locations, like this morning, for example.
It's only 2 miles, said Lewis,
a round man in his 40s, bald with pale eyes. He was fluent in Spanish and understood Mexican culture very well.
They're sending the usual federal escort, 2 trucks, 4 motorcycles, and with our 3 vehicles, that'll be plenty. It's only an 8-minute ride.
Vaught had seen the world go to shit in 8 minutes.
I'll brief my people and get them ready to roll, Vaught replied.
His mother was from the state of Jalisco, so he had family in Mexico and grew up speaking the languages of both countries interchangeably. This had enabled him to form an immediate rapport with the ambassador.
I wonder what she plans on asking for today. Our own air base right here in DF?
Lewis chuckled as he turned away. Avenida Reforma is the most direct route.
I'll make sure the proper arrangements are made over at the Senate building. Let me know if you need anything else.
Vaught assembled the other 9 agents of his security team in the motor pool behind the embassy. They were all hand-picked, each one a former operator with special forces. All of them had seen extended tours of combat.
Here's the deal, guys. Downley managed to piss off the Mexican delegation yesterday. So today they want to meet at the Chico Tencatl a couple miles from here. That's the building where the Mexican Senate meets, for those of you who don't habla.
The others laughed.
They're sending the usual escort, so the run shouldn't take us more than 8 minutes, but I want you guys max attentive the entire way. Are we clear?
There were a number of Rogers and Aye-Ayes in response, depending on the agent's former branch of service, and they broke up to prep the transports. 3 black Chevy SUVs with bulletproof glass and doors. Vaught took aside his number two man, an African-American named Uriah Heen, also a former Green Beret. I'm putting Sellers in the lead vehicle with the trio. Jackson and I'll be in the middle with Downley, her two aides, and Ambassador Lewis. You'll bring up the rear with the other three, but make sure Bogart's behind the wheel. I want somebody who can drive covering our tail. Clear? Uriah gave him a nod. Clear? How'd Downley screw up? Vaught spit tobacco juice onto the concrete, tired of swallowing it. She suggested setting American A-teams loose down here to fight the cartels. I guess it went over like a fart at a baptism. Uriah chuckled, rubbing the back of his shaved head. Who'd she do to get this appointment? Alice Downley was a highly educated 40-year-old brunette, with a photogenic face and an infectious smile. But she wasn't exactly known for her political acumen around the D.C. social.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.